In a socially distanced world, Design United is an optimistic digital platform for collaborative design and connection. Design United was created in March 2020 during a period of intense lockdown and quarantine measures within the region. The aim behind Design United was to create an optimistic space for regional dialogue, connections, collaborations, and opportunities for young regional designers and design practices. A much-needed network of support and peer mentorship during these uncertain times. Talented young designers and design studios working on design innovation with an approach that is relevant to our South Asian region have been invited to be a part of the platform. We also encourage design students from the region to share their work, be involved in the dialogue, and to be an active part of Design United. Design United, most of all, believes in creating a community of designers and design knowledge that is largely contextual, with focus on contributing to the environment and our community. Design United believes greatly in a spirit of collaboration and idea exchange. Good evening. In a socially distanced world, Design United is an optimistic digital platform for collaborative design and connection. Welcome to Design United's sixth design conversation in conversation with Avinash Ankalge. I'm Varna Shashidhar, founder principal of a regional landscape practice, VSLA, based in Bengaluru. I'm supported by Claywork Spaces and our own wonderful Design United team in this endeavor. The aim behind Design United is to create an optimistic space for regional dialogue, connections, collaborations, and opportunities for young designers and design practices, a much-needed network of support and peer mentorship during these uncertain times. The selected designers and design studios have a deep resonance with the place they are from. They believe in genuinely contributing to the environment and the design community. We have had wonderful young designers and moderators from the region in the past who have joined us in our past five conversations. Bogar Studio and Studio Maid, Arnai Studio, Be Polite, Compartment S4 from India. We have had Kavan Balasuria from Sri Lanka and Studio Neba and Kalpa World from Nepal. A young design team supported by interested designers and an editorial team works on the content of Design United. So please join us every Friday at 4:30 for this conversation. Clayworks, who is supporting this endeavor, creates flexible, tech-driven, service-oriented spaces that focuses on productivity and sustainability. With this background to Design United, let's move to the much-anticipated conversation today. I'm delighted to welcome our presenting designer for the evening, architect Avinash Ankalge from Pune, India. His presentation will be followed by moderated discussion. So please type in audience questions for Avinash, which will be answered in the discussion that follows the presentation. Avinash Ankalge is from the D.Y. Patil College of Architecture, Pune. He was a protege of renowned architect Sanjay Mohe of Mindspace. Avinash started his own architectural practice this year. It's based both in Pune and Bangalore. Avinash is interested in discovering unknown architectural heritage in India and the research and documentation of unknown buildings in India. He's currently researching the ruins of the past to try to implement this knowledge in current architecture. So let's join Avinash today as he takes us through his wonderful drawings into the past and his learnings from it.
Hello, everyone. This is Avinash. First of all, I would like to thank Design United, Varna, and the Clayworks for giving me this opportunity for sharing my thoughts today. So I would like to take you a journey through some of my travel diaries, the places where I visited, and I seek through this journey. A few years ago, I visited a place called Farabagh Palace in Ahmednagar, where I actually visited this place around 4 years back. The right slide is Dhaka Assembly, Lui Khan, which is like in Bangladesh. This place I have never visited still. But somehow after traveling this place, I could get through some clues what Khan understood of this. He must or must not have visited this palace. But somehow I could connect this through that, whatever elements he used in that. So after that, the search began for the beginnings. So what are these beginnings? So I love beginnings. I marvel at beginnings. I think it is beginning that confirms continuation. If it did not, nothing could be, what would be. But Khan says it very well. Few years ago, we traveled from office where I used to work in Mindspace to Istanbul, Turkey. So before that, I came across this Le Corbusier's A Journey to the East, a travel diary, the legendary kept in when he was in 24 years old. So it's like a formative journey of his journey. So this book gave me some references or some ideas like how the travel diaries or the sketches through these years he worked. So again, last year we visited two of his best parts, like the Ronchamp and La Tourette. What he says is very well, like to be modern is not a fashion, it is a state. It is necessary to understand history, and he who understands history knows how to find continuity between that which was, that which is, and that which will be. This is out La Tourette. One of this, the Journey to the East book. So what Le Corbusier founds, like in one of his, like 1907, he travels to this monastery of Ima, which is in Florence. So what he says in the to express this structure is like, I worked for that what men need more than everything, silent and peace. Le Corbusier, one of his greatest inspirations was this Ima monastery for the La Tourette, which he does after 50 years. So you could imagine like, you know, the journey he visited like maybe around 20, 30 years back gives him a clues for what it could be later, which was like one of the learning lessons for me when we visited this La Tourette, the section from that rising slope. So it's just like a kept on a slope, like the, without disturbing the nature. Internal chapel of the La Tourette. The left slide, you can see the monastery of Ima in the Florence. It's the La Tourette on the right. Again, I came across this book called Lu Khan's, like drawn from the source, the travel sketches of Lu Khan. Like what he, Lu Khan also travels Europe 2 times, like one of in the age in the 30s and when he like after the age of 50s, like after the second travel, especially in he sees this Acropolis, Athens, and the Sun Bath pyramids. The entire journey of his things changes later when the Khan does this after this Europe trip. He sketches more like he sees forms bathed in sun shadows, monumentality, mass, and structure. So after we see Lu Khan's projects after this second travel journey, he changed totally. Like if you see his strokes, like you know, the columns are not green and yellow, but he paints very. This is one of his, again, Siena, where he travels in the Italy. So what he says is like, I saw the shadow and the sun here, not the plaza. So you can see the connection from the main plaza to the cathedral on top there. So what I feel is a drawing as a thought or a drawing as an idea. I worked 9 years in Mindspace, like architect Sanjay Mohe sir. So what I like it's like how he used to like sit with us and draw the sketches, and the idea of like starting from like immeasurable to the measurable thoughts, like how he transcends from the conception to the reality. Like we learned a lot from those discussions through sketching and drawing by hands. So drawing as a memory and drawing as a journey, how this transcends, like in search of the ruins, Like for me, it's like a process of meditation to see the ruins. It's a process of involvement. Like it engages you in the process. So you keep asking questions, like it's like a storytelling process for me. Like how I am made, or how I was earlier, how I became now. So that journey is very interesting when you visit any dilapidated structure of your old ancestral house, or even a fort or a temple. It tries to complete a picture by itself. Like it anticipates you. What are these old form, new form? Like can we recreate the new forms out of it by understanding that form and formlessness? It tells you a history and culture of a particular place. It tells you memories and celebrations from that place. Tadavando puts in a very well way. Like I like ruins because what remains is not the total design, but the clarity of thought, the naked structure, the spirit of the thing. This is one of the ruined temple we visited in Ambazogai near Maharashtra, where the few carved stones are remained, but you can see the naked structure, how they must have built it, or how the layers were there inside. You can see here as well. So what remains is the strongest part of the thing. Like it gives clues. The strongest parts, like the stone foundations, the top brick layers. So you can see the thickness, almost like a 1.5 meter, and what is there inside. Again, we visited few dilapidated houses, like a courtyard, large courtyard houses in Maharashtra, where this was quite interesting for me. Like it's only three walls, but in between central, the house is all demolished. Like it is ruined after a few years. Like it gives you a curiosity, like how will it be the plan of this? Like you could see here, the three walls are remained. But how the inside, like courtyards will be in two courtyards with the shared values, or it will be like a different multiple courtyards, or the planning will be in a very dynamic way. So it tries to engage you to complete a picture in various options. It generates a curiosity within us. Since only the three walls are remaining, the central portion is gone down. This is in Bijapur, again, Barakaman. They say like it's unbuilt, like it's unbuilt in a different way. Like they left it like that, like for some reasons, maybe some political things and all. But it gives a very different pictures for me. Like it's a series of arches which is left unbuilt for some reason. It tries to abstract the concept of incompleteness in architecture. Like still you capture the essence without completing it. Framing the sky, the intangible element of the space through abstraction. This is how I just try to reflect it in a different way. This is unbuilt, like the same skyline if you take with a different sky, like only the dominating the sky. You can create a backdrop and a foreground for both. This is how I call that unbuilt abstraction. This is watchtower in Naldurga Fort. It's in Usmanabad district of Maharashtra. This is just a watchtower, like actually the wide flights of steps you climb up, you connect to the sky. But one wonders like what this must have been built for. Only for watchtower, or it houses a palace or something to store in. The scale is very, very dynamic, and it's a very monumental kind of thing. You can see the proportions here. So I just curiously start drawing the section, like how this is the existing one. The first, like one floor, they have things to store in between. So I could wonder, like I felt somehow this is incomplete by its nature, or it is just left incomplete. So can it be like this, or they would have imagined like this, or they wanted to build it? So I'm not sure. I don't have an answer for this. I'm just finding it. The search is still going on. Is it possible to think or imagine or draw a building after it? It becomes a ruin at the planning or a designing stage itself. So I started asking few questions about this thing, like old forms, new forms, forms, formlessness, unfinished forms. This is one of from the sculptures, one of the fort. Like it is ruined, but it is still abstracted by itself. It's like a minimal. It is a bull you can make out with its posture, with a very minimal ways. It doesn't have a head or a legs, but still you can make out. This is a statue of Ganesha. Again, you don't need head or any other detailed way of seeing it through. So the perception of seeing how you see one things like in a different way. Again, these are sculptures from the Madurai, one of the Madurai temples in Tamil Nadu, where you see only the legs and the movements of it. You can make it like which which forms they are playing or which forms they are performing without any, the complete detailed sculpture. In 2014, in Guggenheim Museum in US, this Indian abstract artist V.S. Gayatonde exhibits his exhibition. He is no more, but the abstraction paint is like what he does. Like it's a, like they give you idea of silence, the void, that nothingness. So I just try to like when I visited, we saw last like few months back there was an exhibition in Mumbai of his works. So we saw like it's like almost 9 feet high paintings, which again like when you in front of the paintings, like I just try to like contain, you know, like this is the left side is in Bidar Mosque actually. This is also in a ruined place. But I try to connect that, the color way he has used, the layers, like maybe I just felt like 9 to 10 years he must be applying those layers over the layers. So the same thing happens in this these monuments, no? The worn out, like it becomes a painting, like it's like a three-dimensional painting. You just get into a painting and you are wrapped with a painting, the idea of that. So why can't we like try to recreate that or rethink in that way? This is Mr. Rabindranath Tagore, where he starts painting at the age of 75 when he is. So same thing, I again try to reconnect it, the way he used colors with his pen and ink techniques and the way the worn out ruined monuments have become, like the layering and over the years, how the layers have been formed. So I again ask a question like how this process of illumination can be drawn, like removing unwanted inappropriate elements and reversing the process of creativity. Generally, we start from a raw stone and then you get into a finished object. So why can't we just reverse that process? Start from like put in everything, start removing slowly things and get it to a real spirit, like what is a like essence of the thing. We could go through a few examples now. This is Farah Bagh Palace, what I showed the slides earlier in Ahmednagar. So this is a part Google image of the Ahmednagar district in Maharashtra. This is where you see that palace is placed with respect to the urban city. It's outskirts. Like this used to be a water earlier on like on a Charbagh principles. Now it's a barren. It's like almost a ruin outside the city where it's like it's not conserved actually. So what Khan used to talk about is ideas of servant spaces and the master spaces for activities and climate to reduce the glare and heat problems. From this is, you can see here the outer layer and the inner layer. If you could draw a section like how you get it to, this is the inner layer of it, these are the outer layers. And there are a few openings within these bastion-like walls, then you could connect at the eye level as well, you could connect to the sky line from these one opening to the others and beyond across the build through. These are a few, we draw a few online, on-site sketches. The ideas of, in this monument, what I observed like this, the openings within openings, like the, for the, like, you know, the form within the form, what Khan has almost used in most of his places. Like this is the right is, I am in the bath again. So I could connect few elements, those travel with that. This is in Madurai again, the light falling across the Garbhagriha, and it gives you a direction to move along. Like it gives you a direction for Pradakshina path. This is again the Farah Bagh Palace. This is an overall section where the you enter almost in a triple light space, again the double light, and it gives you the central portion. When you reach, there are water channels within the to humidify the air within. These are few drawings drawn on the side. We visited again a few years ago this Kailash temple, Ellora, Aurangabad. Like where you see that carved out quality kind of a thing, where you could walk over the roof, walk over the wall, walk over the corridors, like it's like a non-building where it doesn't destroy nature, but it becomes a part of nature. What Korea talks about in his idea of Bharat Bhavan, it's like a non-building kind of a thing. same Ajahn, it's a Kailash temple. Could see, or you could walk over the roof and could connect across. This is in Ahmedabad, the stepwells, where it tried to create again the layerings within it, and you could again connect across the horizon, under, below the, like below the earth. This is in Naldur, it's called a fort in Solapur, where the ruins are placed in, where this was used to be a temple, and you could connect from that horizon, you come down from all the way from this territorial fort wall, and this is how the section works, where the interconnectivity, visual balance, everything is captured in a very different way. This is in some temple, Modena. Again, this is a North Karnataka, Bendegumli, where we visited one house and we tried to measure draw it in a very different way. This is the entry for a house, and the outer wall is like a almost 2.5-3 feet stone, rough stone. This is a store kind of a thing. You enter, first you visit, like you get to see the cattle fields completely here. You take a left turn, you get an open to sky courtyard along the veranda, and these are the utility rooms like bedrooms, kitchens, in the living room. Living room mainly happens in the verandas, where it's like a raised platform from this courtyard level. This one staircase takes you through the first floor level. This is how the section works. Like I was trying to, the house was almost like a 200, 250 years old. The walls have become like complete worn out, and plaster has come out. The stone you see, the brick you see, how it has come. Like this is the open to sky court you see there, and there's a, it's like an open to sky terrace. So actually the light, it's like a, it avoids the rain, sun inside, but still you get that indirect light from north light from that point to the end of the room there. And again, through this one smaller opening here, and through here, you connect it across again, the horizontally. This is how it is inside. These are a few pictures of the same, like you could see the entry, the large boulders almost. Can you get in, there's some part of a store. This is the cattle area, and this is how you see the open to sky court, which is like a covered court, not the open to sky. This is that window what I was talking about. You get connect across horizontally again as you enter, and it's actually placed in center. This is the covered terrace actually. Again, the veranda covers on the top, and the right hand side is a open to sky terrace you could access from. You could see the double light from. The entire village had like double light, triple light houses, like a very modernized way. I could take you a few examples, like in search of water, you know, like what water meant to me. Like I will show you three structures, where one is a temple, one is a palace and for a king, and one is a priest house, just we visited in Kerala. Like the water in India is a very sacred element for us. So sometimes it's like a giver of life, and sometimes it's like a taker of life. We will go through the journey through this Gomukh temple, Lonar, Maharashtra. It's a very unknown place. The setting is really amazing, the way it has situated with respect to the Lonar crater. This is how you enter and go down. This is a plan of the Lonar crater. This temple is situated in the rim of a Lonar crater lake. In one of the Kund tank, the temple, there is an eternal water stream. This temple is located somewhere there. You could see the red circle. So this is how it opens up from the temple to the Lonar crater lake. Somewhere there, you could see the temple. This is the plan. There's a main road on that side. You could get in a shifting axis line. And as one starts approaching to the temple, the small but intimate archway with a shifting axis leads you to an cross archway, weaving the glimpses of the Lonar large crater. This is how the plan, this was in the overall context how it works. The crater is somewhere in the down. The axis shifts when you start approaching the temple, and slowly you descend down to unfold that water. This is how you enter. Then you, there's a cross archway here. This is like a hill. This is just a carved out, the series of terraces are carved out from this hill almost. Like you get into a first platform, then you slowly start coming down, then you approach to this larger kund. There are two sets of kuns here. Korea puts it in very different way. Like, sepals are elaborate architectural constructions built within the earth surface. They make the path down to water a ritualistic pilgrimage, a matter of profound metaphysical meaning, considering water is seen as a giver of life. This is how the plan. We made a major drawing here. Like, we try to go most of these places and try to measure. Like, we try to stay there 1 or 2 day max, and we try to measure each things. Firstly, we get the experience first day. The next day or a half day, we try to measure and come home and try to memorize and get it back. Like, that's what I meant, drawing as a journey and drawing as a memory. Like, it keeps you engaged in the process. The pathway, what you come from this point, it shifts and it descends down. One gets a view of Shikhara of Gomukh temple and the sound from the holy waters of an eternal water stream. The setting of the temple in relation to the Kretar is very marvelous. The temple steps, walls, everything made up of one material, which is like a black basalt stone. It's almost like emerging from the earth as a carved out entity. The Lonar Kretar is a perfect example where the celebration of water and architecture becomes sacred, and the entire building gets scaled with these steps. You can see those steps actually. It's like you can measure this building with just, if you know the steps dimensions, you can measure the entire building, because it's all the layers, all the steps are like just wrapped around this. You could see in a section these layers, like the same step has gone across the layer and it has just wrapped. Like, where one enters and goes into, through and over out its large puzzle blocks. The temple and tank movements within the entire setting is a low key. It's like a non-building. Given scales primarily by flights of steps. The use of levels and viewpoints are planned in a very organic manner, where one wonders how the creator must have thought of this setting. This is non-building temple and tanks with respect to the main crater. This is how as you come, actually, you are not aware of the large crater lake as you are in this level, because you are just surrounded by these enclosures. And these pockets, like these arches, are for changing clothes. And you change your clothes here, sit there and get down for bathing. So it's like an enclosure within the enclosure. There are enclosures within enclosures in this temple. And still you are part of the large crater lake as you come up to these upper levels. This is how the transverse section works, where from the cutting from the mountain back, this is the eternal stream. These are those changing things. And this is largely connected underground, and this water again streams to the Lonar Crater, which is at the end. This is the cross section through the main shrine. Main shrine is at higher level. We enter at this level somewhere in between. And there's a pradakshina path in between this shrine and the main shrine steps. These levels, you get down to these places and sit and watch that water. So this is how you enter at the entry, and the shifting axis, you can see there, this axis shifts here. Then if you turn back from this archway, you start seeing the crater and the lake. You don't see at these levels where what is happening there next. As you come to this archway, then you start unfolding these steps, the shrine and the water. This is how you could unfold as you elevate yourself on higher levels. These are those series of platforms and terraces, what we were seeing in the drawings. When crowd comes, like they acquire the entire with a very different levels, and it becomes a very active, like the traditional swimming pool kind of a concept. This is where one enters the top, slowly descends down the water stream. Just try to render it in a watercolor, a very monolith kind of a feel. We'll get, we next we'll go towards this Thrissur temple. We visited this with our again office people, like priest house, like Vadakkunathan temple near Thrissur, Kerala, where this house is almost like sitting over the water, like two water pools. This unknown priest house is located in the premise of this Vadakkunathan temple. Basically, a house of priest with the central courtyard, two shifting axes from the central open to sky space descends down in search of water. This is, you can see here, this is that entire premise of Vadaknathan temple, the main shrine and the temple. And this is the priest house here. You can see the courtyard open to sky, the sloping roof house, and these two kunds situated over here. Like, it's very interesting the way you come out of the temple and start descending down and to reach at the main veranda. And when you are veranda, actually these two tanks vanishes completely. Like you get into the central courtyard and the first axis, it gives you the feeling of a covered water body. And the second axis is not in line with the first axis. This is how the plan, the overall plan works. Like you enter, and there's a series of columns with a veranda. This is open to sky space, courtyard in between. As you come, if you see towards your left, you see the water. There's a roof covered above this water. So these two tanks are basically like, there are two holy water tanks built on the two sides of this courtyard house with a narrow lens with shifting axis. Both the axes leading to the water down are not aligned to each other. That's the beauty of it. For the observer sees at time the one axis to the water. The smaller tank built for purpose of bathing priests, where because of the privacy, the entire slope roof covers up the steps and the water transition. There is only a little gap left between the roof and the water. The reflection of this water ripples comes along the roof, creating a very spiritual, sacred, dynamic space within. This is perfect example of function of and the privacy and the aesthetics of a room coming down all the way to water creates its dynamic space within. So this is how that section cut across the two pools. This is for the priests to bath, and this is for the elephants and gods to give bath. So this is almost like a double light entry as you descend down. And this actually, when you are in the courtyard of this open to sky space, you could frame that water like it's a reflected water. It reflects the sky. You will see the pictures of it next. The larger holy tank, which is meant for bathing god and temple elephant, the entry to this tank for central open to sky courtyard is totally different from the smaller tank, where one sees the sky water tank properly. So create a totally different experience of one sees the approaches the water and the steps descend down to the water. The experience of approaching sacred water through different volume scales, proportions, and the way one sees water with and without the sky is totally marvelous. And the steps leading to this holy water becomes sacred where the land and the water transition meets. So this we could see now from here, the two entries in a detailed way. And again, the steps are like, at some place it widens, some place again it's narrowed down. It's very different. You could see in the left picture, as you enter the left side the tank, you could frame that water. It's a reflected water with a roof. You could see the light of that water reflected in the sky. If we have to descend down to reach that water, this is how the section works here. This is the tank. This is the approach to the pool. Actually, you don't see the water where the level is down right now. You could see when you reach us, you could see the water there. This is the left side tank for the priest, which the roof has come over the water almost. This is how we enter to the courtyard. And this is the open to sky court. You see the left side axis, which descends down to reach the water. Yeah, this you can see the sky reflected over it. I remembered again, we visited sometime back the Padmanabhapuram Palace, where it has the same feeling. I could reconnect it with a different scales. Like from the main palace, you come down, there's a large water tank there. And there is a small balcony there to sit. And these are like a louvered screen. You get a very nice breeze there and without a glare problem. Like it's very nice to sit there and look at that water ripples there. And as you go down again, you see the reflection of the water and the sky on this roof. This is from the entry. You could see this is the bridge which connects to that balcony there. It has a small opening. Again, you could connect across there. This is how it reflects when you go down. This is from the outside again. This is that balcony, what we were seeing in the section. So this, again, this Baramoteci Veer we visited a few years ago. It is in Satara, place called Satara in Maharashtra. These are a few enclosures like we try to draw in a monocolor because it's fun sometimes to just draw in a monocolor because the structures are always built in a monolithic materials. So it reflects that entire expression. This well was meant to be a water source to all the farms around within the 12 moats. And from the top, visitor can see few tiny walls and the water channels. The well had steps from one inside leading to this middle of the well. There is arch opening. After climbing down the stairs, the gallery has entrances. Onto you see there's one gallery there and you could walk across actually. There are connections, staircase connections within this. It's like a small, like a summer pavilion kind of a palace. And there is a small, there are some small rooms in either way, like there. As one descends down, like these two water levels comes up, it's almost like a bridging, like you feel like a floating wind is water level rises up. This is how the section works in the crossway, where you see the water, if water reaches till this point, you almost float like walking under a bridge kind of a feeling. This is the palace and the gallery on top. This is how the large section works. One climbs down from the stairs, there is an the whole well is divided into like a two parts, one rectangle and other one is octagonal well at the gallery on top. The second arched opening, this gallery opens out to the both sides. When the water level is rise up, you feel that completely. This is the gallery. One could go down, there is a connection from the top steps. This structure resembles some kind of an underground palace, like where the gallery floats in between. Visual connectivity through varying scales and levels has been worked well, very well through the journey one descends down from entry to the well end. This is how you approach the starting. You could actually see the water there. When we went, there was a very less water, so we couldn't frame the water. But you could imagine this same space in the rainy season where the water level rises up till this point. And you could walk across to reach that water. This is how the summer pavilion and the palace on the both sides. This is the water level should rise. This staircase connects across, connects to the first floor where the pavilion and the summer palace happens. Yeah, we'll move to the last part. It's like in search of a sacred light and the sky. Like we will unfold a journey through Bhuleshwar temple, which is in again Maharashtra, some around 70 kilometers from Pune. The temple is situated on a hill and was built in 8th century. Situated in the top of a hill, you see there is a main highway, the Pune to Solapur, and actually you could see the temple, the shikhara of the temple, not exactly. You could actually just connect it with the skyline. So this is how you move across. And what Corbusier talks about is architectural promenade, like the space you move within. The same way Coria talks about in a very different language. He sees it as a very sacred, like you know, the ritualistic pathway. So I could find that connect when he designed this architectural promenade, and Coria designed this, like you know, the ritualistic pathway. He sees in a very sacred way this pathway in all these temples, mosques, and everywhere. So you could actually take turns, and you know, it's like a highly controlled, it's placed on a mountain. You could actually take turns. Sometimes the temple vanishes, and sometimes you see the shikhara. Sometimes you see the backside of the temple. So it always, you know, the way you move from your car or bike, it always makes you a very different visually. It's very, this is the, it sits on this platform with these shikharas, and there are a few smaller shrines there. The journey from the main road to the en route to a sacred hill is a quite experiential way. It unfolds and it lets you discover it. It's known for its classical carvings on the walls. This temple used to be a part of a fort, actually. As one climbs the hill and arrive at the foothills of this temple, one has to climb the steps and reach the Sabha Mandap. Actually, this I was trying to draw, like, as you we will see in the pictures, where it becomes part of a complete mountain, as if it's like emerging from the earth. It just goes down, the section goes down to the earth. So I was trying to reflect that in some of these drawings. Like as you come to this wider steps, you get to this one platform. There are smaller shrines. Like this is built on a heavy, like high plinth, and you have to climb steps again, get through. This is the first impression where you see from the highway. This is how that it just goes into the earth with its brick walls. Like these are the, it starts from the heavy stones, it goes to the brick, and again, this is the internal layer of shikaras, which is again built in a black basalt stone. This is how the plan works. From these steps, you could come to the platform. You again climb few steps, reach to this meditation hall with the Sabha Mandap. Again, you climb few steps up to the highest podium. You get into a Nandi shrine. And the best part of like when you enter here, you start seeing this corridor. So there is an open to sky pradakshina path along the main shrine. So that gives you a natural light like, to the entire temple. As you come there, the play of light, dark, like you get into a darkness. There are three various levels to this this temple. The intensity of intensity from light to dark increases as one moves inside towards the main shrine. One starts becoming more conscious about darkness in search of something sacred. This is how the cross section works along this way, cutting across the complete mountain. There are these few galleries all along this pradakshina path where you could sit, see the light falling on these things. And there are these heavily carved contemporary, like dance sculpture, dancing sculptures here. You could see that, you could sit there and you could just meditate. And it's very, and through across these smaller windows, you could connect across the horizon there. This is how you get a glimpse when you just enter. These are the smaller openings, what I was just talking about in a section. This is, I see it as a light plan. Like, you know, we should, I think, Lucan always used to talk about, can we show the light in the plan? It's a very interesting idea, where I was just trying to capture that, how the light is falling in the plan. But it's very interesting idea, like I found, where you, can you show the light, how it is falling in the plan, not in sections. This is how the entire section works. The first level, then you climb the Nandi shrine. Then again, this is very, very differently done. You could see the plinth going up, down, and you know, the various levels for activities and for sitting purpose. This is how it again, there are these stone carved basalt. This temple is completely built in a black basalt stone, single material used for all roofs, walls, flooring, which gives feeling of rock carved out from a single rock. The unique feature of this temple is the light falling from the open to sky pradakshina path. Because of the change in sun angle through the day around the main shrine, there are these beautifully carved sculptures on classical dancers. Those gets illuminated. It is like, it's hardly like a 2.5-3 feet gap to the open to sky space. And you get light only from those slits. Each movement, each turn makes you discover something very sacred and divine presence of a different world. This is how the cross section works. In the play of light and darkness, as one moves through these spaces, there is always a story written with the help of carvings and sculptures about this place. There is constant play of different textures, materials, light, dark. Display changes as sun moves throughout the day. It's more about climbing up within the earth and connecting to the sky, which is an intangible element of the space. At Buleshwar Temple, one gets an experience of darkness in which one starts asking questions about one's presence and one's existence in life. This is what is the power of architecture to move us in the presence of the atmosphere. This is a central corridor. And this is, I was just trying to abstract it in a very, how it is merging within its context where it's built. This is the entire skyline of the with respect to the smaller shrines and the main shrine. Yeah, we could see from here now, from the highway, you could connect across. You just see those shikharas. Then you start climbing the hill, the promenade, the movement, the ritualistic pathway to reach that. It vanishes. Some places it vanishes. Again, at some point, you get a glimpse of that. You become more curious what is there inside, like why it is taking so much time and why it is playing with us. Like you slowly get in. And it slowly unfolds you with this context. Then you get a few glimpses of these smaller shrines at some place. Then these wide steps connect you across to the main podium level. You climb wider steps, come to the main podium and get into the main Sabha Mandapa. Then you climb up from the Sabha Mandapa with few steps to get into a Nandi shrine. And then suddenly you become aware of this darkness. I think sometimes spaces should become dark to appreciate this light and the sky. So you could see this corridor and these sculptures are bathed in the sunlight. You could connect to these places very easily, but like not only architects, but I can see the reactions of the general people also, how they like. There are very few buildings where both like a general public and architects gets connected. This was one of that, what I experienced. The light only falls on these sculptures, like as if it is meant, these sculptures are meant to receive that light and show its depth. Few are very abstract. You could see the step, the movements, but it's again ruined the sculptures. Can we rethink of this idea of illumination again through these images? Yeah, I think, thank you very much.
Thanks, Avinash, for a spellbinding presentation filled with gorgeous drawings, your personal observations, and a thought process that gracefully connects art, architecture, space. It really filled us with awe for the vernacular architecture of our country. Thank you so very much.
Thank you. Thank you for giving me an opportunity. Just to share much.
With this, we open our session for conversation. We invite the audience to share your questions to our presenter. Please type in your questions for Avinash. I would also like to take this opportunity to introduce and welcome our moderators for this conversation. Architect Shashani Kure from Colombo, Sri Lanka. Shashani is a junior architect at Palinda Kannagara Architects. She loves both art and architecture. She's joined by our second moderator for today, Devanshi Shah, a young architect from Mumbai with a special interest in textile and graphic design. Welcome to both our moderators. And with this, we open our session for conversation.
Thank you so much for the amazing presentation. It was really wonderful to see your artwork and the way you've expressed all your work. So I think all of the listeners also would like to know, what is your process when you actually go to site, and how do you, see your buildings, and how do you, what are the aspects that you look at before you actually paint, and what is your process like?
I feel it's a more intuitive process. It may vary from like each person to person. What I feel like what we generally we do is like we go to a place for at least to stay like a 1 or 2 days more. Like we go there, we first feel the space. Like one day we could just observe and rethink of what it is for and what it is built. And then maybe a half day later, maybe after lunch or maybe a next day, if we are staying there, we try to analyze it, we try to measure it and in a different way. Like, and then we come back and again, we try to reflect it with those measurements. We try to redraft the scales, like, because that's the only way. If you redraft and rescale to the scale, like you could try to connect those drawings, like especially those measure drawings to like, we don't know like what we were discussing just some time back, like, so if you draw something at this stage, like maybe after 20-30 years you might get a fuse or you might get connected with that thought. So it's always fun to come back and draw those sections and try to draw, like try to scale it up. What we have drawn is and what you have drawn with the scales. And it's always a very exciting moment when you join these the on-site drawings and after coming back drawings. Like, and then you create a document where, you know, it's not for it to use somewhere or it's not for to like just to get idea from those, but it's just a very, very different process which we keep enjoying that. So it's like very intuitive, like it might vary like what I try to do in that process.
Yes. I do agree with the intuitive that it's a very intuitive process to actually go on site and, you know, make your observations. And it's really wonderful to see the efforts that you've actually taken to, you know, study our history and to understand our roots. You have looked at all these monumental architecture buildings and, you know, how they have evolved over time. And, you know, so my question is that, so especially after the industrial revolution and after globalization, everything started being mass produced and, you know, traditional and authentic techniques, vernacular architecture, it started to fade. So buildings started to get a very monotonous tone, and all the residential and commercial buildings started to have this monotonous effect, especially in cities. So what do you think is the relevance or the importance to actually study our history and these vernacular and, you know, traditional and historic buildings?
What's happening now is because of this current scenario, the globalization of it's there's no fault, like, but because of the requirements, the aspirations of the people and the way needs are flowing, like, the context again, like in India, if you see like in the north to south, you know, we have a variety of where we see like in north Rajasthan, there is a different architecture altogether with the materials, the people, the way they wear their dresses. In Kerala, if you see again, it's very different because of the climate and the context. So everything reflects. I think the architecture, all culture reflects in the buildings, like. So it used to happen earlier because of that all climate, context, the people, and the real thing used to come out, not like, you know, the ornaments and all. What I feel over the period, it started, it's becoming the same all now, like all the cities are becoming same, all the buildings are looking same, but they those characters somehow we are losing. But it's like, it's again like building in a context in the right way. If you respond to the context and what it needs, what the building needs. So if it goes beyond the function, it's all different. But I don't know what the question you are asking, I'm answering. Like it's, I feel, there is no fault of what current scenario is going across, but I think we should always try to stick to our principles and where the building is getting built. Like it's what I just reminded one Charles Correa is one of the lectures he mentioned, like architecture is like built in its own context, like it's built in a soil, like the musical events or the dance performance can be played if we play in India, it can be the same performance can be played in anywhere, no, in Europe or America. But the architecture can't do that. Like it has to have a context where it gets built. Like we can't create the same copy building in a different context totally. But I think it's a soil and the context where you are building it.
So, sir, another question I would like to ask was, in the presentation, you compared a mosque of Ahmadnagar to a building in Dhaka. So, from your point of view and after discussing such factors, important factors in architecture, have you come across any buildings, current monumental buildings, which expresses the same clarity compared to our old monumental buildings? Have you come across any similarities or differences of those two, of the past and the present?
There are quite a few buildings I've seen really in India, like what we have experienced, like we used to work in Bangalore, like still we work. But we saw this I Am Bangalore by B.B. Doshi, you know, over the years, like almost like 8 to 9 years, almost every 6 months, we used to go there whenever new trainees in our office or new architects joins. Like we used to accompany there, and we used to, again, we used to get a chance to visit that or to that building. Like after six months, you go there and you try to discover something new always there. And what I try to, when we went to again Madurai and this Tanjore and these Chidambaram temples, what Mr. B.B. Doshi tries to extract those, that idea of incrementality, the way the temples are, like this Meenakshi temple in Madurai, almost 400, 500 years back, but still, you know, it suits to its context. Like it acquires or it accommodates so much people, and because it's that incrementality, what it has built. Like the same, in a way, you know, what this I Am Bangalore has been trying, like the stone walls, the floors, the concrete, and it's like built almost in a natural kind of a way because of the natural materials maybe. But I could try to connect those, my experiences, which we had in those temples, especially in Tanjore and Chidambaram, where I could connect a few of his thoughts in while moving across those corridors, those double heights, and it has a variety of spaces again. So I could connect that one building somehow.
Okay. Agra, Aminash, you also mentioned a beautiful quote by Tada Ando, which just said, "I like ruins because what remains is not the total design, but the clarity of the thought and the naked structure." So if you look at it and if you actually think about it, sir, how do you think about our current buildings? What do you think about it to be in 100 or 200 years? As in, do you think that the same effect will actually happen in another 100 or 200 years?
I think may not be sure, because the earlier buildings has some different purpose, and like they were built in those kingdoms, and the kings had a very different vision. Like over the like Kailash temple, they have built over 150-200 years, over like 7 to 8 like generations, what they say. But now in the changed time, like this the present context, I don't know if we could afford these like generations building the buildings over these years. Like it's very impatient nowadays. Like people want it very fast. Like 1 or 2 years we want to finish the buildings. So over the time, like I don't know, and the materials used in those buildings were like stones, and the craftsman skills we used to have in those days are very rare. Yeah. And the time, money, like everything is, it matters at a stage. So it all depends on those, where we have to give a time. We should have patience to build those kind of buildings at this stage, and which is meant for a totally different purpose. But again, the time demands now, like after maybe 100 years, you want to use that space for something different. It should be more flexible. So I think we should try to reconnect those, like in a present context, how that multifunctionality of spaces, like it need not to be preferably for a fixed function. Like, you know, what happening in now in this COVID situation, few of the buildings are trying to reuse it for this present scenario. So why can't, this is a good idea, I feel. We shouldn't stick to few ideas and get into emotional or a nostalgic feeling. We should try to learn from those buildings and move further. But we should try to, I think, found the new principle. The spirit has to be expressed, but I think it should be suitable to the present scenario. I think how things are happening. But what you said as like the same thing, like the buildings are becoming more and more thinner, and the glass and the aluminium, the idea of darkness is almost gone. The idea of light, experiencing light, the way we used to experience all these buildings, that is almost gone, which we don't know how it will go, because all technologies are coming, technology is taking over, how it will go further.
I'll open up the questions to the audience. So we have a question from Devi Nayar. She says, "Your narratives and sketches are very absorbing and thought-provoking. Thank you. Do you wonder if in the future, modern ruins would emulate or give out the same sense that we feel when we see the older historical rich structures of the past?
Yeah, it's a good question. Modern ruins, I like that idea. Like, it's a good it's terminology, modern ruins. Like, that's what we were discussing in one of that slide, you know, like the reversing the creativity, like creativity process. And we reverse that process of creativity, thinking of what will happen after 100 years. Like the earlier times, those kings and those people used to have that imagination where they used to imagine things after 100 years. So that sensitivity, I think we are losing day by day. If that sensitivity we have, like after 100 years, what is going to happen? Then surely, I think we can do the modern ruins, which will be like the modern heritage for us, like so-called not 500 years historical heritage, but it's like a modern heritage. Like, we should start asking questions. I think, what will be our modern heritage? Like, what we can show to the younger generation maybe after 50, 60 years. Or again, we are after, for those people also, are we taking them into Ajanta, Ellora, or, you know, the Madurai temple? What will be the modern heritage? I think that may be a good question to rethink or ask. Everyone should ask, I think, in that way. Like, I don't have an exact answer for that, but I think we should just channelize.
Another question that we have from Kutub. He says, the artwork and structures themselves explore the thread of spirituality in architecture. What would you, Avinash, define spirituality in architecture?
It's very philosophical and tough question. I don't know. What is it again?
He says, the artwork and the structures themselves explore the threads of spirituality in architecture. What would you define spirituality in architecture?
It's very different, but it's I think it's all, like, I always feel that the darkness and the light, you know, like from any darker, like those transitory spaces, you know, as you move across from those transitional spaces, so like from a dark to light, and that it varies the volumes and all increasingly. I think and when you reach to, there is no spiritual, like spirituality, again it's like it varies, but you try to connect it somewhere, and you try to become yourself when you visit a place. Like you forget everything and you just try to think why. But this particular space is doing that for, like, it's connecting to some a very different world. So maybe that kind of a feeling is maybe a spirituality for me, where you visit something and you try to connect to yourself and a very sacred feeling. I think that can be a spiritual art for me, where you try to question yourself. Very few buildings does that, I think.
Okay. So there's another question from Vallabha Viswanathan. He asked, what structures built by our generations could be considered as contribution to the continuing legacy of architecture?
Can you just repeat, please?
Yes. What structures built by our generation could be considered as contribution to the continuing legacy of architecture? What structures built by our generation, which can be considered?
Actually, the same thing again. What I was talking about, like he's asking a particular building or the process. So I'm not getting it exactly.
More of like general aspect of it.
Like, in your opinion, which would you consider? Which buildings would you consider?
Yeah.
Present buildings,
from this generation, from this,
yeah, that's what, it should be very sensibly done, suited to the actual context. And I think we shouldn't lose that what culture or what craftsman skills we used to have, that is dying day by day, and we are replacing those with the technology, the CNC cuttings, and, you know, the hand skills are gone. So what I feel, can we just combine those both principles, the hand and the machine, like the structures built by those two methods, like the machineries are taking over the hands, like what we used to have that skill, you know, in India, what used to know for that earlier, but it is dying day by day. So can we those structures which will be built by these both technologies, you know, the skill, the hand, the people, with a more effective way, I think those buildings I would like to, maybe those buildings can have that answer.
Thank you, Architect Avinash. We actually just closed questions from the audience.
Thank you very much for all participants attending and giving me an opportunity to share my thoughts. It was a wonderful discussion and the questions.
Thank you so much, Avinash, for a wonderful presentation and spending time answering all the audience questions. The questions and discussions will continue on our Instagram page. So please share your feedback for the wonderful presentation by Avinash on our Insta page. Also, thank you, moderators, for this wonderful discussion. Audience, Clayworks, and DU team, for your time. Have a great evening and weekend ahead, and see you next week for our upcoming conversation. Thank you.